Hello and welcome. You're watching FII. I'm Sonal Mehrotra Kapoor. So you have some money on the side, and because it is pandemic, you're not traveling, you're not spending much either. It is work from home, and you've been thinking about investing. How do you want to invest that money? You can think about stock market, you can think about mutual funds, real estate. Many people are saying crypto now, but the safest bet still in a lot of Indian mindset remains to be gold. That's a very short way of putting in your money, likely to escalate in the years as well, and will surely give you returns. But if I were to tell you that you could invest in gold as much as just 1 rupee, would you believe me? If not, then you need to watch today's program, where we tell you everything you need to know about the new sensation, which is digital gold, where you don't need a demat account for it, you don't need to physically access gold, you don't even need to visit someone. It'll all happen on the click of a button, and you can buy as little as gold worth 1 rupee. That's right. Let's get into our explainer with that. So let's cover some basics here. What is digital gold really? It is a new age way of buying the yellow metal. Now, no need to physically hold the gold at all. Digital gold can be bought online, stored and insured in vaults by sellers on behalf of the customer. So it's a third party really doing all that stock taking for you. It is secure. It is backed by SEBI. It has registered trustees as well. And you can buy for a value as less as 1 rupee. You can buy or sell 24/7, weekends, public holidays, none of that really matters. All you need to really have is internet connection, mobile banking, invest time, and you can just do it from anywhere really. Also, the good part here is that you get 24 karat gold, which is 99.5% pure, certified by the government license agencies as well. So there is, in terms of security, nobody's really doubting that. But how does investment in digital gold actually work? How do you make it happen? Well, the transaction is routed through mobile internet banking. Transactions go on the market rates, market rate of the day. You confirm the order like you book your meal, like you order a burger or a pizza. You get a OTP to verify that, and instantly that amount is then credited, and you get a certificate that you have made this order. And that order of digital holding of the gold, you can even sell later. And none of that time will you need any transaction or any holding of the gold altogether. You can start your investment with very little amount, and you can go on to buy at various levels really. And that really makes it such a big sensation. But like any asset over there, there are some pros, there are some cons when it comes to digital gold. Let's talk about the benefits first. Well, it's very convenient. As you can make out, it's instant purchase and sale. The good part here is there is no making charge. There is no minimum investment. You can start at 1 rupee. There is no hassle of staring, sort of going back and storing it somewhere, keeping it safe, wondering where to really keep this. And purity, that comes certified by a government licensed agency as well. Disadvantages, well, there are no making charges, as you would pay for any jewelry. You would pay for something as much as 29% if it was the jewelry that you were getting done. If you're getting coins made, that would go up to 7% making as well. None of that making charge is part of your digital gold, but there is GST, but that's also 3% really that happens. It does come with a maintenance cost, however, that takes care of things like storage, of insurance, etc. It's not much, but still that charge is there. But the biggest drawback here is that there is lack of any official government-run regulatory body, such as RBI or SEBI, that is overseeing any of these things. And companies may offer limited storage period. Now, this is crucial. Why? Because you can hold digital gold for only a limited period of time. After that time lapses, it's different really for the company that you're buying it from and the portals that you're buying it from. You have to take it in sort of physical form, which is a bit of a downer over here at this point. Also, you have to take it in physical delivery. That means that in case you cash it, there could be taxes on it, etc. But let's give you a comparison now of how is digital gold different from physical gold. Okay, when it comes to purity, well, purity might not be if you're physically taking it from somewhere. Now with hallmarking coming in, things have become a little easier, but earlier that was not the case. So there in physical gold, it's about 99.5, and here the price is guaranteed, the purity is guaranteed. Comes to price now. Price is not uniform versus price is completely uniformed in the digital space. If you're buying physical gold, you need a big chunk of money. There is a particular amount of grammage that you have to invest in. If you want it in coins or jewelry or even bonds, etc., there has to be a limited lock-in period or a limited amount of money. Well, none of that is really a factor over here when it comes to digital gold. Also, 20 to 30% of gold's total value is making charge. Remember, like we said, and this is generally if you want to buy it as part of jewelry, etc. But when it comes to digital gold, well, none of that, just a 3% GST. Storage hassle, of course, is extremely easy here. So you don't have to go out and take lockers, fit in jewelry over there, or fit in your coins or any of that sort, because this is literally taken care of. All right, so that is a very basic idea about what digital gold is all about. But remember, when it comes to gold, this is not the only means of investment. There are bonds out there. There are also, like we said, you can invest in the stock market and you can trade it over there as well. So there are various options really when it comes to gold. So with the panel today, we'll be looking at all of those and doing a comparative study on how does that really fare, a digital gold versus the rest. Let me first go to Sanchita, back with us on FII. Always nice to have you, Sanchita, with us. Just take us through, I've mentioned some of the very basic points when it comes to digital gold, but if you compare that to, so say, those who are invested in bonds, bonds wherein, just a basic, for the benefit of our viewers, I'm just saying this, whenever you do invest in a digital gold, there is a company which is physically buying and procuring that gold for you. The difference between bonds and digital gold is that in bonds, you don't procure anything. It is just a written order by the government or by the authorities here, which tell you that this is what you hold and this is what your standing is. So majorly a comparison comes between bonds and digital gold. What's your take on that?
Thank you, Sonal. Well, these are two very different asset classes. A bond is a promise to pay, right? And gold is, well, gold, it's a metal. Also, a lot of times when you're talking about gold, let's understand there are two aspects to investing, or rather buying gold, right? One is buying gold for the purpose of consumption. So in India, traditionally, gold has always been bought in households for the purpose of consumption, which is jewelry, right? Wedding purposes and all of that. And storing in lockers as a security, essentially consumption. When you're talking about investments, it's a very different ball game altogether. That is where digital gold comes in. Digital gold, gold ETFs, sovereign gold bond, which is your SGB, right, which also has a cash flow component. Now, why do I mention the cash flow now? That's very important. When you're talking about an investment portfolio per se, and you're going ahead and comparing a fixed income instrument with gold, then that cash flow component is very important, because bonds have coupons, right? They make interest payments. So that there is a cash flow component. Does gold really have that? Is that your requirement in your portfolio, or are you only using that as a hedge vis-a-vis equity or any other such volatility? So all of these factors come into play when you look at gold as an investment asset class.
Right. So very important to understand why you're putting your money there, and that should really be your deciding factor on which mode you're really getting into. Very important point made there. Let me go to Renisha now. She's the research head at Want Gold for All. Renisha, take us through, what is your thought on all of this digital gold being talked about so much online? It's a huge topic of discussion here.
Hi, Sonal. Good evening. So gold is always considered as, the major traditional value for Indians. And digital gold now is the most easiest and a convenient way for millennials to invest in gold. And as we were talking about how we should compare it with SGB and gold ETF, I would say liquidity is the main major differentiator here. So in digital gold, you have access to gold prices 24/7. You can buy gold 24/7, while in SGB and gold ETFs, they are traded on exchange. So you have a limited time period, 9 to 3:30. Only that time you can invest in gold. So this is a major differentiator which Digital Gold gives. Moreover, in SGB, you have a lock-in of 5 years. And the maturity is of 8 years. So right. before, if you that, if you withdraw, so you have certain, you know, transaction costs to be paid. But a digital gold, if you're buying it today, you can sell it the very next day. So this is also a major thing. Those who want to take the, you know, just the price difference and take the benefit of the price rise in short term, in almost, you know, a week or a month's time. So right. digital gold is a very, very good option. If you are looking for a long-term perspective, yes, one should go for SGB, I would say. But for shorter term, I would say digital gold is a very, very good choice rather than buying it for, you know, physical gold.
Short-term investment in asset, that's the space you're saying digital gold really occupies at this point. Gaurav, your thoughts?
Yes.
Yeah, so I agree that it's a good investment option. But I think the consumers where it makes the most difference for or it makes the most sense for are those who want the option of physical delivery. Because there's a large body of consumers we find who want to buy it and they aren't really sure. It's part investment, part that, you know, I may convert into jewelry at some point or I may get a coin at some point. I think that's the singular feature where digital gold stands out. For example, we have integrations with 2,000 jewelers from Tanishq and CaratLane and Candere, Kalyan. So you could just walk into any of those shops, go to their websites, and you know, if you've got 5 grams of digital gold, you can convert it into 5 grams of jewelry. All you need to do is pay your making charge. We find that to be super popular with customers. So many will invest and they may sit on it for a year or 2 years, and then they say, hey, I want to buy some jewelry today. And you know, you bought gold prices, that you bought gold, gold prices have gone up over 2-3 years, and you've locked in your gold. So now when you go to buy jewelry, you've kind of got that nest egg saved up. So I think that that is the use case we find most popular with our customers.
Right, and millennials also jumping in on this bandwagon at this time. Let me go to Nasir. Now, Nasir, give me your analysis. When you see different modes in which you're seeing investment come into gold, I mean, do you see this impacting people investing in physical gold altogether? Or if you look at returns also, how do you view this compared to, say, ETFs or the sovereign gold bonds, etc.?
Yeah, good evening, Sonal. So, you know, I'll tell you, I think that's a very interesting question. See, gold has, as an asset class, has been very, very popular, right? We've seen that mostly in the current situation, for example, the last 18 months or so, Sonal, we've seen a lot of rush also because of the pandemic, right? People move to safe havens, such as gold. I mean, let's understand, the global currency today, I would say, apart from US dollar, is gold. I mean, everything that you can track to is gold and gold prices. And us as bankers, I must tell you also, we track gold prices internationally. Having said that, I think some of the avenues that are available today is clearly, you know, the very popular retail investors like to invest gold now through mutual funds. There are mutual funds available which invest in gold ETFs. I think my one of my panelists said, Sanchita mentioned about ETFs. Very, very popular. Retail investors can invest as low as 5,000 rupees to start with. Subsequently, you can do SIPs. So again, it comes in through ETFs. It's either exchange traded funds in place of physical gold. You can just go and buy. There are available through Nippon as one of the asset managers. Kotak is also one of the asset managers which is giving these options. So, you know, retail participation, number one. Number two, I think as far as the entire, you know, landscape of physical gold is concerned, you know, storage costs, issues of maintenance, issues of security, I think some of those have been playing on a lot of investors' minds. And even broadly, I can say today, you know, people, even amongst the younger couple, are looking at parking in money through digital modes in gold, whether it's through ETFs or through, you know, these digital gold that option that you can invest, which is basically to ensure that, you know, you want to kind of save money at current gold prices and subsequently going forward, you know, you get the benefit of direct gold prices moving ahead.
I see.
Now, the only distinction, the only distinction that I would want to bring about as compared to some of the other inputs that came up was, I think, you know, if there is an investor from an investing perspective, Sonal, if there is an investor who's looking at and a profile is conservative and is looking at investing, say, for a period of 5 to 8 years, then I think a sovereign gold bond makes sense. However, if you're looking at, if you're a moderate to an aggressive investor and you're looking at purely from an investing perspective, then maybe, you know, you can look at digital gold. Because the main distinction here is of the risk appetite. Gold bonds are far more secure because also please understand there is a sovereign guarantee, right? When I'm saying a sovereign guarantee, I'm talking about SGBs which are available through primary issuances that the government is issued through RBI. They come in with sovereign guarantee as compared to, you know, digital gold, which has, well, in a sense, obviously from a purity perspective, it is a little more pure as compared to SGB also. There is a 0.01 bip difference in terms of purity, in terms of higher level of purity.
Right.
But there's also an interest component which is paid out to you tax-free. Right?
Yes.
So
yes,
that also brings in its own set of benefits.
I think that's where the bonds actually score a little bit. You actually get an interest back on it at 25%.
That's right.
If I'm not wrong. Right. I have last 30 seconds. And Sanchita, I quickly want you to weigh in on this capital gain tax, really. That is on everybody's mind when it comes to investing. So if we were to make a comparison very quickly on procuring gold physically, digitally, through ETF or through SGBs, how do you see that going?
So, all right, I'm not a taxation expert. However, being a mutual fund distributor, the basic taxation which is there, both on the physical and on digital gold and on ETFs, is that gains from the gold investments held for less than 3 years are taxable as per the investor's income tax slab. And for investments beyond that, more than 3 years, the gains are taxable at 20% with indexation benefit.
Okay. All right, we'll have to leave it there because we're short on time. But this was a quick and easy way of understanding what really digital gold is and how does it fare against the rest of its competitors out there in the market. Thank you all for joining us. We're going to slip into a break. On the other side, Vaccinate India. Welcome back. Now it's time for a special campaign, Vaccinate India, in partnership with Google, where we're discussing questions that you might often have about vaccines, about antibodies, and so many others. Taking your questions today will be Dr. Narang. Thank you so much, Doctor, for your time, and welcome back on NDTV. Just want to start by asking a very back-to-basics question over here, really. And if there is any doubt in anybody's mind about the safety of the vaccine and COVID-19 vaccines, what would you tell them?
Well, first of all, COVID vaccine is very safe. Now, even in India, 55 crore people have received the vaccine, and there are not any disasters or infection. It has proven beyond doubt that it is working for the serious cases, preventing the hospitalization and preventing the spread of COVID. And we are now reduce the cases, and we need to continue to vaccinate so that we can further keep the COVID third wave away.
Right. So there shouldn't be any doubt in anybody's mind right now, because so many of us have got vaccinated, world leaders and everybody across the globe, really. So nobody should be waiting and watching. Just go and get vaccinated to the nearest spot possible, which actually brings me to the next question that people often have is, where can they actually get themselves vaccinated? Now, we're at a very interesting time, Doc, in our vaccination journey, where lots of corporates are coming in. They are organizing camps. RWAs are organizing camps as well, and you have all the helps in your house, all your people who work for you and you work with you as well. There are so many options now available, right? So really no excuse to not get yourself vaccinated anymore.
Well, most of the places where the vaccinations are done, first of all, it is very good that the big houses and private players are coming and bringing confidence. Wherever they're getting vaccination, they are taking due precaution. Say any reactions come, they have a facility to look after that. So one should take the vaccination as far as wherever they want to go. Even in the government setup, I have a personal experience. They are doing it very well.
Right. Okay, so just if I could add a question to that, Dr. Narang, since you're a pediatrician as well, just there is so much talk still about whether vaccines are safe for pregnant women, if vaccines should be, if women who have COVID-19, etc., should they be feeding in their kids right now? If you could just answer those queries as well.
Okay. Well, vaccine in pregnancy, in breastfeeding, both are safe. Why people initially don't get confidence, because when the trials are done initially on the normal subjects, and then these all are added. And during pregnancy, during breastfeeding, it is not only going to benefit the mother, in the pregnancy it is also going to benefit the child, unborn child, because some of the antibodies will get transferred to the baby through the placenta, and will give some benefit. And this is seen with all others. All others, like pertussis vaccine, with other vaccine, all mothers get tetanus vaccine during pregnancy. So it is very beneficial. Rather, if we practice that every pregnant woman gets the injection, then those patients who are delivered and get COVID during the delivery, we can avoid the direct spread of infection to the child.
Right. You're saying actually the child stands to benefit, as the antibodies could be transferred through placenta as well. All very important points over there. And thank you, Dr. Narang, for your time and taking us through all those answers in very fascinating details over there as well. Well, that's it on Vaccinate India. We'll see you again tomorrow. Bye-bye.